Both the essentials and the full version of the platformer game engine include some basic enemies you can use to add challenge to your levels. To make a robust game, you're likely going to want to add some additional enemy variants with different attributes. The most easy way to start adding more enemy variety is to simply change specific aspects of any particular instance of the basic enemies. As an example, I'll make this first basic enemy much larger, and then go to its platform behavior and change its maximum speed to slow it down. When I run the level, you'll see the newly sized enemies, and when the player bounces off of or shoots the mini flying enemy, the regular basic enemy that is spawned matches whatever size we've made the flying enemy in the layout editor. The variable respawn duration in the flying enemies is used to set the respawn time of the basic enemy it spawns once it's been hit. If you set that to a negative number, the flying enemy will never respawn after the resulting basic enemy is destroyed. You can switch the sine wave movement pattern of any flying enemy from vertical to horizontal. The game engine will automatically make it change the way it's facing when it turns. Playing with these few aspects of the enemies can give you a large amount of variety in the game, but variants that look and behave more differently will be our next step in making a fully realized original game. While the basic enemies use standard construct sprites, it can be very helpful to animate your enemies in Spriter and then export the finished animations as full-frame images, which you can then import back into the game project. We've provided the Spriter project for the basic enemies, which you can use to easily create new variations. But first, back in Construct, we need to create a clone of the enemy we want to create a variant of, then give it a new name. Now in Spriter, let's load up the SCML file in the folder called Basic Enemy. Now start editing the body part images in your graphic editor of choice, clicking the refresh button in Spriter after you've resaved the images. Continue with this process until you are happy with your new enemy variant. Be sure that every animation is fully changed to the new look. Now we're going to find the animation that takes up the most space and set a custom trimming rectangle that will accommodate all of the animations without trimming off any of the art around the edges. Too large is better than too small because you can crop the images frame by frame later in Construct. Now choose File, Export Animation to PNG or GIF, then turn on Batch Export and expand the dialog box to see the list of entities and names. Uncheck all the entities you don't need to export and make sure it's set to separate numbered image files. The next step is to decide at what scale you want the animations exported. If you want this new enemy variant to be roughly the same size as the default enemy, then set this to 30%, then click Batch Export. Then choose or create a new folder for all of the animation frames to be exported to and click Save. Now let's get back into Construct and double-click the new enemy variant so we can import the new art. Find the animation frames palette and right-click on an empty spot inside and choose Import Frames and choose From Files. Now use the Shift or Control key to multi-select all the frames for the animation and click Open. Now delete the original frames. Repeat this process for all animations until they are updated with the new art. Now go back to the first frame of the first animation and set its anchor point near bottom center and copy it to all animations. Also edit the collision shape to make it a clean rectangle shape with its bottom matching where the ground should be, and copy that to all animations. The two frames of the animation called D-winged are the first two frames of the die animation. As you can see, in my example I've created a variant of the basic enemy with spikes on its back. If you look in its variables, you'll see one called Top Vulnerable. Change this value to No, and you'll see when you play the level that the player gets hurt by landing on the enemy instead of killing it. We can do the same thing with the flying enemy, however we'll have to overcome a slight problem in the events after we follow the same steps we did for the ground-based enemy. Once the new spike-backed flying enemy is otherwise all set, let's go to the Level Events event sheet and search for Basic Enemy. Now find the event that handles collisions between the player fireball and the flying enemy. Right-click the leftmost edge of the event and choose Replace Object. Replace the Fly Enemy group with the Flying Enemy sprite. Now copy this entire event, and this time replace the basic enemy sprite with the new spiked basic enemy we had previously made. Now when you run the game, you'll see there are basic flying enemies and spiked flying enemies. And when hit, they properly spawn their wingless equivalents. Beyond these two basic enemy types, the full version of the basic platformer game engine provides an additional two. The first is this stompy enemy. Just drag its sprite where you want it to start. Then set its variable timed or react to either timed. If you want the stompy enemy to repeatedly stomp, then return to its original position regardless of the player's position, or react if you want the stompy enemy to only stomp if the player is below it and within a certain horizontal distance from it. The stompy enemy has a jump through platform behavior. Leave this enabled if you want the player to be able to land and walk safely on its back, or disable it if you want the player to get hurt if they land on it. H range is the horizontal distance in pixels the player must be within for Stompy to stomp if Stompy is set to react mode. Y under range is the vertical distance in pixels the player must be within for Stompy to stomp if it's set to react mode. Damage is how badly Stompy will hurt the player if the player is hit by the actual stomp motion. If the player hits Stompy while it's not stomping, then the player loses the default 1 hit point. If you set damage to a high enough number, it will make the player die instantly if they are stomped on. Wait for stomp is how many tenths of a second are counted before each stomp, after Stompy gets back to its original position after the previous stomp. Countdown is the actual variable used to count down from the wait for stomp value. This should be set to the same number as wait for stomp unless you have several stompies and you want them to be offset with each other in timing. Backup speed controls how quickly Stompy will go back up to its original position after stomping. Stomp speed controls the speed of the actual stomp. Screen shake controls how violently the screen will shake when the stomp occurs. The second additional enemy is for the water. This fish enemy sprite is a variant of the flying enemy, except it doesn't spawn a basic enemy when it's destroyed. It automatically generates bubbles, and it changes to a biting animation when the player is nearby in front of it. Make sure when you place the fish enemy, you adjust its Z order to be behind the water tile base object and adjust its sine wave movement so it does not swim through solid land or go outside the water area it's in. The attack damage variable controls how badly the player gets hurt if the player touches the fish enemy while it's playing its biting animation. A future video will show how to add totally new enemies and hazards from scratch. Thanks for watching.